Welcome back to Rush Hour. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are still
discussing HIV, the history of it, and what it means for Uganda to have a target of eliminating HIV by 2030. With me in studio is Dr. Deo Wawire, physician with Muju, and also now joined by Maria Antonia Narubega, Miss Positive Central.
Yes, yes.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so
I'll
much.
I'll come back to you, Maria. Let me come back to Doctor. We finalize the question that we've been handling before we go to the young people. The issue of why has it taken long to have a cure? Is it because of lack of research or other issues?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mubarak. I think there is a lot of research that is aimed at finding a cure for the HIV virus. However, because of the nature of the virus itself, the fact that it replicates or reproduces at a fast rate makes it prone to undergoing some mutational changes. Mutations are changes in the protein that constitutes the virus, and these make it elusive to most of the treatments that we currently have, and also makes it difficult to find a cure. But in addition to that, there are certain reservoirs in the body where the virus hides, and I think most of the available drugs cannot get there to get rid of. Once you have HIV infection, the HIV virus tends to embed in your DNA, and it uses your DNA to replicate. Mm. So the challenge is how to force it out of the DNA so that then it can be wiped out by the current interventions. Mm. So currently, and the future, I think, is concentrating on finding drugs that can drive it out of the DNA so that it can then be eventually wiped out by the immune system and also the current interventions that we have.
Absolutely.
And also because of the mutations, changes in protein content, is quite difficult to find a vaccine. So that is another area that has stalled because of the frequent mutations in the virus. However, nevertheless, there are efforts that are ongoing to try and find a cure and also a vaccine.
A vaccine for it.
Yeah.
How did young people get involved, and how did they started getting involved into this? Because we knew that the time you were actually dealing with this in the 90s, it was mostly among the adults. How did young people get involved?
I think of course, we know that HIV is transmitted from mother to baby. So over time, inevitably, the young people had to get involved because there were many that were born with HIV. But also because, as I said earlier on, one of the risk factors is one of the issues that drive the HIV epidemic in our country is transgenerational sex and underage sex. So inevitably, they got infected. But I think it was not until in the early 2000s when we had antiretroviral treatment that I think people started involving children in HIV-related programs, particularly through treatment programs, and also creating psychosocial support groups to help support the children. And at that point is when we started to create psychosocial programs for children so that they would support each other and they would also share their concerns with us and also with each other as a way so that we develop programs that are tailored to empowering them and also to provide them more friendly services like you see, you know, maybe if they are school going, they will not be available probably during the working time. So we then started to think, based on their feedback about maybe running evening clinics, weekend clinics, more friendly clinics for them where they have peers who then support them. So this was, I think, in the about 2003, 2005 there, when people were now having more ready access to antiretroviral treatment.
Absolutely. Maria, I want to welcome you on the show. First of all, how did you get to know your status, and how did you come up to say, this is my status?
Well, as it's mostly known, and it is true that basically HIV is mother-to-child transmission. So I basically got affected from my mom breastfeeding. She probably didn't know our status. So in that way, we didn't have the program yet of the mother-to-child transmission, how we can handle that, and the mother could have a negative baby. So that's basically how I got infected. And then how I came to know about my status, that's basically where I was taken to an organization where I grew up from. So there, it was basically an organization that takes care of young children living positive. So all my life, I grew up taking medicine. They didn't lie to me. I wouldn't say, like, other parents could be like, you're taking medicine for pneumonia, cancer, and all that. But I'll just take. Not until I was about 12, then I was told about my status, HIV positive. And then this is why you're taking this medicine, to help you with this and this. So that's basically how I got to know about my status.
Oh, so you were given medicines before you were okay taking them without knowing the reason?
Yeah, I
was
okay.
Until you got to 12 years.
Yes, I was okay. Because I was monitored. Medicine is there, you take medicine, and after I'm given a banana, why not when you're a kid? Let me take the medicine and I eat my banana.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
so in other words, You are you the one who first asked why you were given such drugs or what?
No, I didn't ask. But the rumors around, and then when I grew up and started was able to read, like, so this was basically an organization taking care of young children living with HIV. I was like, okay, so HIV, and then school it's HIV. But I think they were waiting for the right time to tell me that, Maria, this is this and this, and this is why you're taking this medicine. So I basically didn't ask.
How was your experience in school?
My experience, it wasn't bad, since it was an organization where it was known for taking care of young children living with HIV. But again, we could have other children from the community joining us. But they knew that all the kids that were staying in there were positive. And of course, stigma doesn't, you know, just can't lack anywhere, regardless. Sometimes it may be silent, but it is always there. So still, yes, it happened. You could hear someone say, you know, this quote that really disturbs most of us, and we feel like it really has to be eradicated from whatever they say. Like someone says, Abana bai nasilim.
Yes.
There is a way it sounds really strong and then hurting. So that's basically what they could say. They're like, okay. But the fact that I was surrounded in an environment where I was loved and taken care of, you know, I could have counseling sessions. Once I was really bothered about it. Yes, it hurt a little, but it wasn't of that great effect to me. Except when you had to go out, let's say going out for church, and then so many people say, I wanna be in a sleep, blah, blah, blah. Like, okay, that's a little bit harsh.
Did you feel a little judged?
Yes.
Have you ever been judged by the community on why you're positive?
Yes.
And how is that?
It's challenging. It's tough. It's torturing mentally. Sometimes you sit back and like, okay, now the challenge I have three brothers and then other siblings. And then of all, I'm the last born, but the only one positive. So of course, you sit back and like, okay, God, let's talk about this. I'm the last born, and why is it that it's me? Why does it have to be me being positive? And then the whole community knows that it's me positive. So sometimes you could feel judged, and sometimes it doesn't come from the community, but you yourself. You're like, okay, why me? But the moment you realize that, you know what, Maria, I have nothing to change about this. This is me, and I learn to accept you learn to accept yourself, then you just have to do with it and just choose to live life. But stigma, it's always there. You just learn to know how to handle it.
Absolutely. Dr. Deo, you have had stigma. How much impact and effect does stigma put on people living with HIV?
I think it has a lot of negative impact on their mental health. It creates a situation of anxiety. People feel unfairly judged, and they are psychologically tortured, and many of them end up with depression as a result. So it's not a good thing, and we must find ways to fight it and bring it down.
Is it something that is taught in schools? Is it something that is taught in families? Or it is misinformation, disinformation? Should I say ignorance? What is it, Doctor?
I think it's rooted in maybe culture, society. It's not that it's learnt anywhere, but I think, as you said, partly it's because of lack of information that people behave the way they do. It's not as bad as it was, because I think earlier on in the epidemic, people did not know how HIV was transmitted, so maybe they thought, well, if you get in contact, if you shake hands with somebody with HIV, you will get. If you share maybe utensils, you might get HIV. If you share beddings, but over time, I think people know how it is transmitted. But the stigma has not gone away all the same. So there must be other underlying factors that we need to investigate, I guess, and have a better understanding.
Maria, how does it feel coming out openly and say, this is my status and you are fine with it?
It's a decision that you choose to take yourself. I mean, it was a pageant that almost everyone knew about, but not everyone chose to come out. So it's basically a decision that you make. And sometimes you're like, okay, let me just do it for the sake. Let me try it and see. But it has to come from the bottom of your heart, because you know, once you do this, almost the whole world, you know, this world looks a little bit big, but small. Someone can see some from Karamoja, and they're like, I saw that girl on TV, she's positive. So basically you have to believe in yourself and be like, you know what, let me do this. Regardless the outcome, someone knowing about my status and everything of that sort, let me do this, not just for myself, but also help someone out there. Because there's so many young people like, I'm positive, that means there's no life for me. I'm positive, that's the end of me. But when you choose to come out, you're like, you know what, let me do this for someone out there to look at me and be like, she's positive, but at least she looks good, at least she's doing something great. So it's basically to empower the young people out there to know that regardless their status, they still have a bright future and they can be great people in the nation.
Paint for us a picture of that day that you first came out publicly and said, this is it. What exactly happened?
Wow, actually the first day I did it was during the pageant. Yeah, we first had the central auditions, so I joined. I'm like, okay, honestly, I was so green about almost everything, but I was like, okay, let me give it a try, because I've always heard about it. So when I went, I was like, okay, Maria, this is it. When you go out there, everyone is going about your status. Are you free with it? I'm like, okay, let's do this. So I did it.
You must have lost friends.
I don't really have so many. And besides, most of my friends know my status.
Oh, yeah.
And then for a few, I remember going back home after the pageant, and then the nationals where I was crowned second runner-up, Miss Y Plus Uganda. I went back home, and so many people around where I saw, like, hey, like, seriously? Because, you know, they had to post your photos and then your bio for you to get either Miss Popularity, something like that. So everyone's like, so seriously, all this time long, you're positive. I'm like, guys, it's normal. Like, how can it be with the way you look? Like, it's just the fact that you just have a different picture of someone being HIV positive. So many parts, so many questions. And somehow you could feel the stigma around, mm-hmm. and then you could see yourself losing some friends, but regardless, you knew that I was doing it for someone out there, and it's okay for them to go just because they don't understand the mm. real thing about HIV, or they don't understand the real thing about what I did.
Mm.
So, of course, you always lose friends.
Some colleague told me that those are not your friends. Your friends will love you regardless of who you
Thank
are.
Thank you. Love but you Dr. regardless Wawele, who you are.
Of what importance is it to know one's status? I mean, why do I need to know one's status? You know, my status. I have had actually this conversation with many of our friends, colleagues who are telling me, I have friends who actually get scared of getting to test, and they were telling me, but I would rather die without knowing. Of what importance is it to have to know your status, and what contribution does it have to the fight?
I think it's very, very important for people to know their HIV status.
Mm.
First of all, for their own health, you are able to live a more positive health lifestyle. Nutrition wise, exercise, and other things. You are also able to get initiated on treatment, which improves your quality of life,
mm.
improves your life expectancy, and you live a normal life like any other person.
Mm.
But in addition, if you suppress your viral load to undetectable levels, there are additional benefits to the community, because if you have an undetectable viral load,
mm.
you are unlikely to transmit the HIV virus to the mm. others. But even if you had a detectable viral load and you know it, you are able to use other avenues of other methods of prevention
mm.
to ensure you don't pass over the infection to others. The use of condoms, the use of paper, and other interventions that are currently available. So there are many benefits of having, of one knowing their HIV status,
mm.
both for themselves and for the community.
Absolutely. Maria, they have actually been saying that we have had, you know, research coming out to show that young people these days want to have HIV message on social media, digital and all of that. Do you think the current message that is preaching against HIV spread really resonate well with the young people, or there is something that is missing out?
I'll give credit to the young people for their efforts that they've put to see that their voices are heard about HIV and how to go about it.
Mm.
And yes, I'll say they've put so much effort to it. But again, the request that we have is that when we are trying to preach against whatever the myths are going on, against stigma, and trying to bring out the voices of the young people, we would ask and request that the public, and well as the elder people, could support us in all this. That just say you have, like, the organizer UNIPA organizes a pageant, and we see that it has really done so much to try and eradicate stigma and discrimination among young people themselves living HIV positively.
Mm.
So our request is that maybe it could be supported more, but yes, we see that their work in preaching against HIV spread and everything of that sort has been brought out well. All they need is a little bit more push from the bigger people, the doctors and very many other people, like social media platforms. Mm. So yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think the media is, you can be our partners
yeah.
In educating the public on the currently available interventions for the prevention of HIV and also for
mm-hmm.
the treatment, so that we can increase the uptake of these interventions, which eventually will translate into a reduction in HIV transmission and possibly the total elimination of HIV. So I would implore you, the media people, to
that's
come
why actually we are having this conversation
and,
here.
We appreciate
we have to wind up this conversation. Let me start with you, Maria. What message do you have for the young people out there watching you, you know, as we are building up to the 1st December?
Okay, to the young people out there, I would say life living HIV positive is a little bit challenging. right from yourself and then to the community, because there's so many myths about HIV that are still around, that regardless how much you may try to tell someone about it, they'll be like, ah, you can't tell me anything about that. But one thing they have to know is that regardless of HIV status, whether you're positive or negative, you have to put it in mind that that is not going to change. We are working so hard on ending HIV by 2030, but before we get there, you just have to learn to love yourself the way you are and for who you are, regardless the words around and everything going on. You just have to learn to love yourself, and don't just give up because you're HIV positive and because the society said you have nothing to do with life. When society said you should just give up because you're HIV positive, you're dying soon, darling, that's not right. You still have a very long time to live and so many lives to change. You just have to stand up for yourself, believe in who you are, and trust yourself for who you are. Because stigma is still around.
Yeah.
But you can fight it with loving yourself first, and then later preaching to the community and sensitizing them that stigma doesn't change anything.
Absolutely.
It doesn't make anyone better, not me or you or even the society around.
Absolutely.
So you have to learn to love yourself and keep the fight. Try abstain if you can. Use the interventions that we have already and go for testing. Know your status for the good of you, the community, and those around you.
All right. Doctor, your last message for the young people mostly.
I think one I want to thank is the young people like Maria who come out openly and talk about HIV and help other people, other young people not to get infected, but also encourage them to go for HIV treatment and care. I also want to encourage the young people to go and have HIV testing. If you are negative, then you adhere to the known interventions that keep you negative. And if you are HIV infected, then we link you to HIV care and treatment so that you have a better quality of life, you live like any other person.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Dr. Deo Wabwire from Makerere University.
It's a pleasure.
Yes. And also Maria
Antonia,
Miss Y Plus, Central Region. Thank you so much for spending time to speak to us. It's been a pleasure having you this morning. We want to take a short break. When we return, we want to look at, of course, the other conversation going on in Rush Talk with Maizra Meeting. A very good morning.
Thank you.